Hey there! Is today your first time here? Or maybe your first time in a while? If so, maybe you're wondering exactly who we are and what this church is all about. Well, we'd like you to know that we're a group of ordinary people who are on an amazing journey together, following Christ. Our guide is the Bible because it's the divinely inspired Word of God and it will never take us in the wrong direction. Along the way, we hope you'll see that we are welcoming and spiritually passionate and that getting to know you is a big deal to us. We know that the road is rough sometimes, but we'll work really hard to bring you practical and relevant messages to equip and encourage you through life's ups and downs. We want you to know that we care about this community, and we believe that it's our job to make it a better place. So, no matter who you are or where you've been, we're glad you're here with us today, and we hope that you'll join us on our journey, following Christ and living out His plan for us. So, welcome to church.
Hi, everyone. Excuse me. Well, it's good to see everybody. And praise God. Actually, I'm just going to put the comment section on so I can see you all. That's great. So we have a really good service, I believe, tonight that God has given me to speak to you. But you know darn well it's not going to be me. God will use me as a vessel. And we will pray in Jesus' name that it will be the Holy Spirit that will speak through me directly to your hearts. We're blessed to have Sheila with us again this evening, who's going to be reading scriptures, and she does that so well with an anointing on her. So we're excited about that too. And we've got some great music. Just wanted to announce that if anything goes wrong, and I say this every week with the technological side of things, stay where you are, keep chatting up and back to each other, and I promise we'll get right back on All right. It's just sometimes they might cut us off or whatever might happen. Also, don't forget Bible study on Wednesdays. I just wanted to mention that. And tonight we will be having communion. So if you'd like to partake in communion, make sure that you have a drink of some sort and a cracker or a cookie or piece of bread, whatever you want to use for communion. Okay, so God's word tells us to enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to sing some songs. We're going to worship God together. So let's sing. When you hear a song that you know, sing it, okay? And this, hi, Eddie. See you there, honey. Hi, Joanne. Hi, everybody. So when I put the songs on, the first song that I chose for this evening, and I know it's my husband's, one of his favorite songs, and I think maybe Karen said it was her favorite, Joanne. These are the days of Elijah. And we're going to sing that along with a bunch of Marines. So if you've never seen this video before, watch how these young people come together and worship God together. And then we've got some nice worship songs to sing, and then I'll be back. Okay? So I'm going to take myself off of here, and we're going to put the music on. Enjoy and be blessed. Thank you.
Thank you. worship you because of who you are. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. You are.
Hallelujah. Help me know that you are near. That's something that I think we all need to know, huh? Need to know that God is near. And that's, I'm hoping, what we're going to be able to discuss tonight, and that it's going to help us in a way that maybe you knew before and forgot, or maybe you haven't applied, or maybe you don't even realize. So I'm hoping tonight we'll be able to know, to help know that he's near, right with us. So I'm going to take a throat lozenger, just because I'm well, by the way. I'm healed in Jesus' name. COVID's gone, as well as Larry. Larry's not gone. The COVID's gone. And so we're good. But I've had like cold symptoms still. So I'm just trying to take care of it so I don't start coughing or something. You must be used to that by now with me. Okay, so Sheila, I'm going to bring you up, hon. And me just get this ready. There we go.
Hello.
I always say she's so adorable, isn't she? Okay, I know. Embarrassed. I can do that. Okay. So tonight, what are we talking about? Does anybody even remember? I didn't write it up on the screen tonight, did I? Well, it's a good thing I remember, because we're going to be talking about the altar of our hearts. And this is pretty interesting. I think you're going to get a lot out of this. So we're going to start right away with Sheila. And could you read Psalms 42, 2 to 4? And this is from the New Living Translation, by the way.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I thirst for God, the living God. When can I go and stand before him? Day and night, I have only tears for food, while my enemies continually taunt me, saying, "Where is this God of yours?" My heart is breaking as I remember how it used to be. I walked among the crowds of worshipers, leading a great procession to the house of God, singing for joy and giving thanks amid the sound of a great celebration.
Thank you. Beautiful. So he says his heart's breaking because he remembers how it used to be. You know, when Pastor Eddie preached, that really touched me because it made me remember the joy of my salvation. You know, we've been going through a lot these last few years and all kinds of stuff happening. And sometimes we kind of forget that. And that really woke me up. But here it is. He's saying right in Psalms, my heart's breaking because I remember how it used to be. I'd walk among the crowds of worshipers. I'd lead the great procession to the house of God, singing for joy and giving thanks with great celebration. I remember how it used to be. What happens? What is an altar to you? That's what we're talking about tonight, an altar. In the Hebrew language, it means a place of surrender. This is where you lay down your problems and God Almighty divinely empowers you, helps sort out your issues occurring in your life. The altar is a place of exchange and sacrifice, not to be taken lightly. Whereas you play spiritual gymnastics, right? Up, down, up, down. No. The altar is a special place. After you have placed all your worries at the altar, things should not remain the same. The altar of the heart is a place of consecration, commitment, and holy habits. Holy habits. Okay, Sheila, please read Matthew 11, 27 and 28, again, the New Living Translation.
My Father has entrusted everything to me. No one truly knows the Son except the Father, and no one truly knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Then Jesus said, "Come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest."
Beautiful. Beautiful. I'm using the New Translation, and I told you before, just because it's easy for everyone to understand. And some people who watch this service are either from other countries. Some don't even know the Lord. So I'm trying sometimes to use the easiest way to get God's word across to people. So we at one time years ago, not so much now, but believers, we were known for giving altar calls. I know when I was first saved, I went to the altar. There were altar calls back in those days. And like I said, not all churches give it. Sometimes they have like healing services, but not a lot of altar calls. We have seen thousands of people touched and transformed at the altar. Do any of you remember that? We've seen tens of thousands of people saved, if you've ever gone to crusades that they used to have years ago. Billy Graham or Jimmy Swaggart, all the different people that used to come around and do crusades. You'd see thousands of people go to the altar. And you'd see miracles taking place, miracle after miracle. Thousands of people running to the altar. Why? Because they wanted to encounter the Savior, which is the greatest sight on earth. And we've seen some glorious outpourings of God at different meetings I've been to. I remember one time watching a movie. It was a movie. It wasn't even true life. But in the movie, they were having an altar call and a lot of people went forward. And I'm crying my head off because it's just the whole concept of people giving their lives to Jesus. Even in a movie when it was actors, it still touched my heart so deep. Many places, though, have abandoned that place of surrender and obedience because people nowadays don't like those words, surrender and obedience. They don't like those words. Unfortunately, there's, you know, abuse and all this stuff that's caused people to not like those words. But they're really not bad words if we understand what it means when it comes to God. The altars of our churches don't usually represent what they did at one time. And they become steps where man can ascend to. He's above on this platform. And rather than a place to learn to walk in God's steps. And sadly, we now live in a day when God would be treated like a stranger if he was to show up in some of our churches. Think about that. Could you read Matthew 26, 36 to 39, please?
Sure. This is Jesus praying in Gethsemane. Then Jesus went with them to the olive grove called Gethsemane, and he said, "Sit here while I go over there to pray." He took Peter and Zebedee's two sons, James and John, and he became anguished and distressed. He told them, "My soul is crushed with grief to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." He went on a little farther and bowed with his face to the ground, praying, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup of suffering be taken away from me. Yet I want your will to be done, not mine."
Thank you. So what's he doing there? He's with his disciples and he's getting really stressed out. He's depressed, distressed, anguished. And he's telling them, "My soul is crushed to the point of death." And he just says, "Stay here and watch for me." And then he went further and he bowed his face to the ground. Remember that. He bowed his face to the ground. And praying is where he talked to God from the depths of his heart, bowing his face down to the ground. And he tells God, "I don't want to go through this." But then he says, "But your will, not mine." But he was anguished and bummed out and everything else. And he goes to a place by himself and bows his head down. If we're to experience this transformation power of God, we must return to the altar. When Jesus stretched out his arms on the cross, he was telling mankind, "Now you can have access to meet with God." Jesus' entire ministry on earth was established so that we, you and I, could have direct access to heaven. The altar is so much more than a wooden or marble piece of furniture where we visit or we dedicate a child or we get married or we hold a funeral. People sometimes think of that as the altar. Because of Jesus, the altar is a lifestyle of devotion and renewal in God's presence. Access to God has always been through an altar. Not the altar of material, but the altar of what? What's the message? The altar of the heart. The intention of your heart. Man cannot come to God on man's terms. It's always got to be according to God's terms. Adam built an altar in the midst of his enemies and in the midst of all his problems. Abraham. Every time he made a move, Abraham. You read about Abraham. Every time he made a move, he was building an altar of some sort, and they all have different names. Not only did he build an altar, but he cried on the name of the Lord at those altars. And many of those altars have names of the Lord attached to them. It's a perfect example of what we should be doing. Now, you might not quite get what I'm talking about yet, so let's listen, all right? 1 Kings 19:11-13, please.
Go out and stand before me on the mountain, the Lord told him. And as Elijah stood there, the Lord passed by, and a mighty windstorm hit the mountain. It was such a terrible blast that the rocks were torn loose, but the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, there was a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, there was the sound of a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his cloak and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. And a voice said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?"
So wonderfully read. You see, sometimes we think the altar has to be noisy or some big fancy thing or whatever. It says that all this stuff was going on in the natural. Earthquakes and blasts and rocks and windstorms and all this stuff and fire. Everything was happening, yet the Lord wasn't there. And then all of a sudden there was a gentle whisper. And what did Elijah do? What did he do? He wrapped his face in his cloak. He wrapped his face in his cloak. And then he heard God. "What are you doing here?" And then the conversation started. His altar was his cloak. And the Lord came. It wasn't some big fancy marble place. It wasn't some big fancy with lights all over it and fancy plants and all that. No. He buried his face in his cloak. Jesus bowed his head in his hands. Are you hearing what I'm saying? There are times, even in a marriage, when we just know that we got to get away with each other. It's in those moments when you slow down and you realize afresh that you love each other. And it's in those times of refreshing that your marriage can be restored to a good relationship and gain a fresh vision and passion for what lies ahead of you. Now, the same way we look at that marriage where you have to get away quietly is the same way the most incredible experiences that you can have with the Lord always seem to happen when you have chosen to come away with him. Bury your head in your cloak. bow your head in your hands. Get away with God. To take a sabbatical with God means that you have to stop being seduced by everything of the world, by the excitement of crowds, by the accomplishments of your own selves, and allow your heart to respond to the one who is your lover, the lover of your soul. I read an article called A Time of Altars, that altars represent the occasion and the place where we have had a personal encounter with God. We may not always be able to make a physical altar, right? Get out the hammer, start building a big altar in your house. But there can be one established where? Simply where? In your heart, within you. When we come away with Jesus, we're saying that we desire to see Jesus more than we desire people, than we desire platforms or programs. This kind of transformation requires that we die to ourselves. So is having an altar encounter with the Savior worth that sacrifice to you? If you deny yourself some things of the world right now, and you take time to be alone at your altar with God, and you can have an encounter with him, is that not worth that sacrifice to give up that stuff for an encounter with the God who loves you so much? We can abandon ourselves at the altar. We can choose to crawl off the altar at any time. Nothing but our will keep us on the altar. It's all about submission. Do you want to be on the altar? Do you want to be with Jesus? Jesus modeled submission for us in the Garden of Gethsemane. He understood the price that had to be paid to become our sacrifice and our altar. Even when the human side of him was screaming for a pardon from his father, what did he tell them? Like, I'm disturbed. I don't want to do this. He gets there. He's crying. But he says, thy will, not mine. He understood the price he had to pay. If we're willing to put our lives on the altar, God will bring forth reformation in our lives. A personal encounter with a supernatural God is the only thing that's going to transform you, especially in the world that we're in. And to be transformed by God, we must leave the bottom of the cross. There's the cross. We must leave the bottom where the spectators are standing, and we need to climb up to the cross or the tree of forgiveness and use Jesus as our example. Jesus is our altar, and therefore we must be attached to him. We must be tied to him. Apart from him, you can do nothing. You know, I was telling Larry the other day, the only time that I'm truly happy, besides being with my family, is when I'm serving God. When I'm serving God and I'm with God and I sense that he's with me, and if I'm speaking of God or reading his word or preaching or whatever I'm doing, or just being alone with God, my heart is full. Nothing in this world can do that for me. And my friend was telling me that, like, I'm religious, right? Well, I was trying to explain to her, I don't think that's religious. Maybe she thinks it's religious, and I understand. But in my mind, it's my life. It's just my life. And I hope it's your life. Apart from him, we can do nothing. This is what it truly means to abandon yourself and come back to the one who knit you together in your mother's womb in a secret place. The most important altar we're ever going to build is the one upon which we learn to die to ourselves. An altar without a sacrifice is just that piece of wood or stone without purpose. My friends, there are times when God is going to whisper, and there's other times when he's going to shout. And then there's times when he's literally going to bump into you. And he has his reasons for everything and why he contacts us that way. Perhaps God is quiet because, you know, that old saying, the teacher doesn't talk when he's giving you a test. We've gone through many seasons, especially the last few years, when God's voice seemed quiet. In those times, we've learned to live by our faith, right? Not by sight. And that it is in the quiet of the night or in that cave of despair that God will whisper his secret to you. Have you ever wondered why people seem radically touched at the altar by Jesus? But after a short amount of time, they seem to go backward in their walk with God. So they go to the altar, there's all the excitement, and then all of a sudden, they're back. Worse sometimes. Perhaps it's because they never learned to love God. Now listen, past the gooey feelings, goosey bumpies, and the praise-a-thons that we're at. The altar needs to be strapped to us. It needs to be part of us, not left behind on Sundays, but part of our every day, every minute, every breath that God gives us. We need to be willing to embrace times of isolation. It's when we're at our lowest sometimes that we must realize that God is still God. We sang that song a couple weeks ago. You're still God. Beautiful song. Beautiful words. He won't leave us or forsake us. And that's when we have to realize that he is with us always. So brothers and sisters, I ask you, are you going to hear his voice even if you're in that cave of despair? Well, it's time for us to rebuild the altar. Now, get your hammers out. Go get some 2x4s. If you want some marble or granite, that's going to be expensive, but no, just kidding. Is history going to declare this was the church's finest hour? Or is the world only going to remember us with what the media is trying to say about us right now? That the church was filled with bloated, egotistical, money-hungry, self-righteous people who professed a faith and failed to demonstrate it. Is that what we want? I don't think so. Your voice matters now more than ever. Are you going to speak up? Let history declare that we were those who chose holiness over being a heathen and purpose over procrastination. May we always be known as those who walk in love. So important. So important. Walk in love, walk in truth, walk in power and freedom. The church has to once again become a moral compass of the nation, because it's not in our part of the world. Let's make it our mission, guys, to keep one hand on that cross and the other hand taking back all the lost people from the fire that the enemies put them into, so that the church won't slide into oblivion. Look around you. Churches, buildings are selling like crazy, and they're putting apartments in there, gay bars, whatever they want to put in, churches. We got to keep pursuing the lost, but there's a way we're going to do that. And that's learning where the altar of your heart is. God's created you for a time like this. That's why you're here. It isn't a fluke that you're here. And it's time for us to go public. We represent the altar to lost humanity. We are ambassadors of Christ. We are faithful to seek God at the altar, Together, we're going to see a harvest like never before. It's time to rebuild the altar. There's a song that I want to just read you some of the lyrics to, and it's about an altar, and I'd like to play it, but I don't want us to get cut off. So the song is, the service is nearing an end. The choir is singing just as I am. And now as that old song is played, people at the altar are kneeling down to pray. Some are finding mercy, forgiveness for their sin. Some are fighting battles and they're struggling to win. The time has come to give it to the Lord. That's what the altar is for. You don't have to carry those burdens anymore. There's a light in the darkness. There's a love that's true. And Jesus is waiting. He's waiting there for you. Go quickly now before they close the door. That's what the altar is for. The father is praying with his son, and the mother kneels beside them, thanking God that they've come. An old man is standing there in tears, giving up a part of him that he's held back for years. Hearts are being broken. Lives are being changed. And those who call upon him will never be the same. The time has come to give in to the Lord. That's what the altar is for. You don't have to carry your burdens anymore. There's a light in the darkness, and there's love that's true. And Jesus is waiting. He's waiting there for you. So go quickly before they close the door. That's what the altar is for. Could you please read Isaiah 6, 5 to 8?
Then I said, it's all over. I am doomed. For I am a sinful man. I have filthy lips, and I live among a people with filthy lips. Yet I have seen the King, the Lord of heaven's armies. Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a burning coal he had taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. He touched my lips with it and said, see, this coal has touched your lips. Now your guilt is removed and your sins are forgiven. Then I heard the Lord asking, whom should I send as a messenger to this people? Who will go for us? I said, here I am, send me.
Beautiful, beautiful. So one of the reasons I wanted that scripture was that, you know, he was feeling doomed, like sinful, filthy lips, lips of people, filthy lips. How many of us live around that everywhere, TV, everywhere we go, even kids? But he's crying out and he says, I've seen the King, the Lord of heaven's armies, and I want to basically do what God wants me to do. So the seraphim flew to him. And where did he get that burning coal from? He got it from the altar and he touched his lips with it. And the guilt was removed and the sins are forgiven. And then he said, here I am, send me. The interesting thing is that the altar is such a holy place, if it's properly done, that guilt was actually removed and sins forgiven from a coal from the altar. The altar can be a holy place between you and God. The true altar and the real altar is the heart of God's people. It's in your heart. My altar is in my heart. Your altar is in your heart. And that's where the fire of the Lord burns, at that altar. I hope you're understanding that, because, you know, it could sound a little crazy, but if you have a spiritual knowledge at all, you're going to understand what I'm saying. So the fire of the Lord burns in that altar in your heart. God commanded the priest at the tabernacle, and this was his commission to the priest, that the fire shall be ever burning upon the altar. It shall never, ever go out. That's in Leviticus. He said, the flames shall never go out. The flames of the altar of your heart shall never go out. The same principles in the New Testament tabernacle in the church. The fire must always be burning. It must be burning in the morning, the noon, the evening, at nighttime. There's the mission. That's the mission of the church. That's how we shine forth as light in the darkness. Our altar within us should be burning with the fire of God. Is your altar broken down, my friends? Elijah went to where God required an altar, and the altar was broken down. Do you remember that story? Everyone can see it was broken down. And the first thing Elijah did was what? He didn't build another one. He repaired it. The altar is your heart. So if this is true about repairing the altar, what Elijah did, then you can repair the altar of your heart if it's broken. What needs to be repaired? Is it a broken heart? Is it a hardened heart? Maybe it's an unforgiving heart. Maybe it's a critical heart or an unbelieving heart. All of those things can hold you back from God. God is the God of the heart. The devil is a great enemy, but he's not actually the greatest enemy. Your greatest enemy, my friends, is yourself. And your greatest enemy is your own heart sometimes. You know yourself, there are days when your heart can reach great and holy things. There's other days when the heart of yours can reach terrible things, right? Excuse me a minute. That's how desperate and deceiving your heart can be. The heart can be deceitful, says Jeremiah, above all things, and it can be desperately wicked. That's in scripture. I'm not making it up. Could you read 1 Samuel 16:7, please?
It says, man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart.
Here we go again. The Lord looks on the heart. The heart is the altar, and the altar is the heart. Before God will touch you and me, we have to get our hearts, our altars, mended. We must all start like Elijah, and we have to repair it. Repair the altar of your heart. You know what needs to be repaired. I don't need to tell you, but you know what God can do. He can give you a new altar, a new heart. If any of those things I mentioned, broken heart, you know, you've got all these things happening to you, an unbelieving heart, maybe critical heart, unforgiving heart, that is critical. Because if you're unforgiving, what does Jesus say? If you can't forgive, how is God going to forgive you? Basically, that's my language, but that's what he said. Has your heart been hardened? How are we going to fix this? God can fix it. Could you read Ezekiel 36? It's just one little part of it, please.
A new heart will I give you.
Amen. Elijah, he starts to dig a trench on the altar. He put the wood in order, and notice the word order. He just didn't pile it up. He put it in such a way that it would ignite. He set the wood in order. But you can have order and yet no fire. So let's do everything so that the fire will come. We want the fire back in our hearts, right? He put it in a way that it would ignite. Then he cut the bullock in pieces. Elijah repaired the altar that was broken down, and he digged a trench around it. He lays the wood in order, and now he cuts the bullock into pieces. This man was working, right? You think that was easy? Got to do all that stuff. Digs a trench. cuts the wood, lays the wood in a certain order, cuts the bullock. It's not just taking a little nice knife like we all have and chopping up a little steak. No, this is cutting this thing up. The man is working hard. He's really making an effort to repair the altar. It's not a question of saying, I'll just kneel down on the bench and say, oh God, have your way, and the altar will get repaired. That's not what's going on. God doesn't work like that. Sometimes it takes time to get things right, to fix our mended heart. Sometimes it can be a miracle and it could be boom. And other times we have to dig the trench and cut the wood and put it properly so the fire will ignite properly and put the bullock pieces on, cut up a certain way. Sometimes we got to work. We got to work it out. When you're waiting and you're working, that's when God will start to do the work in your heart, in the altar of your heart, as you're working to get things right, to repair that altar. Ephesians 5:26, please.
Christ loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word.
So he pours the water upon the sacrifice. What does he do with the sacrifice? He sanctified it and cleansed it with the word. That's what Jesus said to the disciples in John 15. You want to read that, please?
Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you.
Amen. The water of the word goes over us and we are clean. Psalm 119, just this one scripture of it, please.
Whence shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereon to thy word. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Okay, so he prepared from noon to evening, Elijah, from 12 to 6, let's say. He worked over 6 hours nonstop to do what he had to do to work on that altar to repair it. Can I ask you a small personal question, just in passing? How long has it been since you worked 6 hours for the Lord nonstop? I know Larry can probably say he has done it because he's been working like crazy, moving all that furniture and getting it all. Probably worked nonstop. How long have you worked 6 hours without a break, without a coffee? There's no coffee break here in this chapter. They're not talking about cookies and coffee, nothing. He worked for 6 hours. He didn't build a new altar. He repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. He had to take away the vines and the weeds. He had to cut away the thorns. He had to take it all away. It had been active and it had been used in the past for worship of God, just like you have been used for worship of God. And maybe the altar of your heart needs to be repaired. When the Holy Spirit looks at our hearts, does he see an altar all broken down and covered with weeds and vines? How does it get that way? By being neglected, out of use sometimes, and that's when it starts to break down. When we forget that the altar of God is right within us. Before God's fire would burn on it again, Elijah had to what? He had to repair it. If you repair the altar, God will send the fire. He will. After I repair the altar, what's the sacrifice then? That's what you're asking me? Okay. You are. Then God sends a fire and God looks down and sees a sacrifice on the altar. The trouble of many people is that they say, send the fire. And the Lord said, where will I send it? Send the fire, they say, just send it. God sends the fire on a sacrifice. And when you lay yourself on the altar, God will send the fire and a mighty work will be accomplished for the glory of God. But you have to understand that the altar of your heart and you are the sacrifice. Remember, obedience, all of that comes in. It isn't a bad sacrifice. They're not throwing you to the lions. It's just saying, God, use me. I'm going to take myself away from all this garbage in the world. I want to be used. I want my altar to be in use. I don't want it just sitting there broken. You know, there was a pastor friend of ours. Larry and I were friends with him. And he gave us a wonderful example, and I'm going to show it to you. And it's just a little quick example. But he used to tell us that we need to go to our personal altars to pray. And he would say, like, well, you know, I don't have the keys to the church, or how am I going to get into the altar, or how am I going to do that? And he took his two hands like this, and he put them together like this. And he says, what we need to do is that we put their hands together, and we put our head in our hands. And while our head's in our hands, you begin to seek God's face. This is your altar. Do you see that? God never leaves you. He's right there. Anytime you want to pray, anytime you want to go to that altar, right there. If you can't get somewhere where you want to get on your knees, or just put your hand like this. God's right there. He's right there, right there, right there. He's that close to you, and he's waiting. That's the altar. You can go there, ask for forgiveness. You can go there to repent. You can go there just to get close to God. That's what we need to understand. If nothing else, right there, there's God. Right there, right there. Never leaving you. Right here, okay? This is just an example of what you can do. What did Jesus do? He put his head down. What did Elijah do? He put his head inside his cloak. Get away from the world. Why do we have prayer shawls? You see mine hanging up there. You put it over your head so you get away from the world and you are in the altar of your heart with God. He's waiting for you. He's waiting there. We're to build that altar to the Lord in our hearts as soon as we can, right away, and visit it once in a while. No, visit it frequently. We should take our sin, our sorrow, our faults, our failings, take it to God at this altar. Offer them as a kind of like a burnt offering. Let God's fire consume them and change you. We need more of this old time teaching. It isn't just la, 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 up at the front of the church and they knock you down and okay, now you're good, get up and you're all done. No, we have a part to play. We need to repair the altars of our heart and seek God daily. I'm sorry, God gives you breath daily. We can give him some of our time daily. We should take our confidence, our joys, and our praise as peace offerings and give them to God and continually submit to him. We can call on the Lord at the altar. We can discuss our requests with God. We can tell him our desires, and we can seek his face concerning those desires. You see, it's at the altar where God answers. Since our body is the temple, and we know that, we can never, ever leave our altar. Our altar is right here. As we maintain that altar consciousness and listen for God's voice, you're going to start to hear him speak to you through his word. He may speak in a small voice. He may speak in an audible voice. He may speak when you lift up your Bible and open it, but he will speak to you. I know that darn well for a fact. Let me pray for you, okay? Let's just bow our heads for a second, and we're going to pray, and then we're going to take communion together. Father God, I just pray, Lord, for those who are here and those who are going to watch later. Father, just like your people of old, today we still desire to connect with you and interact with you. We love you, Lord. We know that Jesus' sacrifice has allowed us to come to you with no barriers between us. We lay aside our pride, O God, as we prepare these altars for you. Show us where we need to repair them, Father. And let us do this, not just hear it and walk away and say, that was a good sermon. No, let us do it, Father. Help us, encourage us, send your spirit to convict us that we do this, O God. These altars aren't made with stone or metal, but they're in our hearts. Thank you, Father, for accepting our worship and responding to us in love. Teach us to live in gratefulness and in joy in our relationship with you, Father. Send us out, Lord, with your strength and your confidence to do your will. Hallelujah. We pray this in the mighty name of Yeshua, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. I'm just going to put the link up. Okay, so we're going to do communion now and prayer requests, any praise reports. If anyone wants to give a praise report, that would be wonderful. Please take this sermon to heart, okay? It's really important. It's important now, you know, there's people of other religions who just get on their knees and pray. They don't care if they're at work. They don't care where they are. We need to be doing more of this. We need to be able to pray and to be able to, come on in, and to be able to just come before God at the altar that he's given us, the altar of our hearts. Amen. Don't be afraid to ask God to help you. I've prayed for you. We've got everything. God's going to be working with us to get all of that straightened out. So, Eddie, if you want to come up, I'd appreciate it. And I don't know if there's any prayer requests. How do you know what needs repairing? Okay, let's do communion first, and then we'll answer some of these questions, all right? Because we're done a little teeny bit early, so I think that we can answer some questions. So, Karen, don't forget that question as soon as we're done with communion. Okay. The link is on here. Are you going to come up, Eddie, or... Okay. There we are. All right. Trying to get this screen right. There. Playing with that. Okay. So, we're going to do communion first, and then we're going to answer a couple of questions and have a few praise reports, okay? So, okay. Eddie, can you do the bread, please?
Yes, I can.
All right, and I'll do the one. Okay, go ahead, please.
For I have received of the Spirit, received of the Lord, that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had took it, he gave it thanks and he broke it. And he said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. This partake of the bread.
And he took the cup of wine and he gave thanks for it by saying, Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam barei pri hagafen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the fruit of the vine. And then he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. And he said to them, this is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. It is poured out as a sacrifice for many. I tell you the truth, I will not drink wine again until the day I drink it in the new, in the kingdom of God. And then they sang a hymn, and they went out to the Mount of Olives. Let's drink this, remembering Jesus' words. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Well, as you can see, Larry got home safely, praise God. I was concerned. He had to drive his brother up to the train station, and it's about an hour away, so he's back safely. So that's an answer to prayer. For those of you who are part of our ministry chat, you'll know that Bobby's doing much better. She still needs lots of prayer, but she's no longer in that semi-coma, and she's able to she has a thing in her throat, but communicate. And I was online with her and prayed with her, let her know that you were all praying. So thank God for that, and we're happy about that. And also, what else? I had another thing here. Laverne is doing better. You all know that she was extremely sick, and she's doing much better. Yeah. Okay, so we have a couple of praise reports. We've got Mary has a praise report. Mary, if you want to come up and give that praise report, I can put the link on again. So Mary, you will click on that link and it will bring you into the studio. Okay, we have prayer for Joanne and Bobby. Pray for the lost and for the found. Pray for Joanne and Mike's dad, Miguel. Any other prayer requests? Looking. Okay, well, if you have any prayer requests, just put them on. In the meantime, pray for your son's salvation, Joanne's son. So, Mary, I'm going to bring you up now. Okay, Mary, so did you want to give a praise report, you said?
Yes, praise the Lord. I have the praise report with me. The Lord is very faithful. I have paid the rent. This is the receipt. Thank Hallelujah. You, Jesus.
Hallelujah, praise God. So you're safe there now, right?
Yes, I'm safe.
That's good. She is in a beautiful location, and her and Shenna are safe there. It's a lovely place, and hallelujah, God provides, doesn't he? Even when we were thinking, oh, where is that going to come from? And he provides. Okay, I'm just putting down some pray for Mary's future. And Karen's family, all of our families, my granddaughter, Carissa, for Kenny. Anybody else? Yeah. Danny did ask us to continue to pray for Bobby, so let's remember to do that. Anyone else have any prayer requests? Sheila, Pastor Eddie, anybody who's on here?
Always pray for my kids.
Okay.
And pray for my freezer. I need to get a new freezer.
Pray for your freezer. Hey, listen, I know a pastor who prayed for his car and it didn't have a battery in it and it drove anyway. So wow, you never know, right? Yeah. He laid hands on his car.
Okay. Debbie?
Yes, hon?
My friend Alan, he has requested a prayer for his cerebral palsy, his disability, and he's experiencing a lot of pain right now in his legs and his body. So he's had it most of his life, well, all of his life. And so, yeah, he's been on here tonight and commented a bit, and he said he would like me to ask you to pray for him.
Okay. We're going to do that. He's right on the list. And we will, all of these prayer requests don't go just once, you know, they're on a list and then they're constantly prayed for. So when you have a praise report, like Mary did tonight, we have been praying about that. When you see a prayer answered, you know, come on, if you feel led to do that and give glory for that. So, because God deserves the glory. Yes, Pastor Eddie.
Pastor Debbie. Remember when I was down there at your place there and I got the message to, if I would speak during on Saturday for the youth group for
yes.
the Halloween thing, that was yesterday.
Oh.
There was about 75 to 80 youth that were there that I got to speak to. So I shared my testimony, how I got saved. A few of them had came up to the front for special prayer. It was a great evening. We had a great time, and it was a real great blessing. And today at the church too, the youth group was still there from last night, so they were today there again as well too. And so the pastor last night says, "And I didn't prepare a message for today. Can you speak for me tomorrow? You know, for church." So. He had me speak for in front of the youth again today, but not share my test, but speak out of the Bible and speak the message for them today. And I did that. And there are about seven of his big wigs that are above him that were there. And they were really impressed with how I spoke. So it was a real blessing. So that's a praise report.
Wow, that is a praise report.
Yeah.
Thank God. And you ministered to 75 youth, you said? That's incredible. Yeah. Praise God. You know, God is moving, even though sometimes it seems like, where is he? He's moving. And all you got to do is be obedient, right?
Yeah.
And all of us remember, now, where's your altar, everybody? You guys on here, where's your altar?
In your
right there in your heart. And when you want to get close to God and you can't find a place, where do you go? Right in your hands or your prayer shawl, or if you don't have one, just put your shirt, whatever, just get away from the world and go to God. Really important. Okay. Inner hearts, right, Joanne? Let's continue to pray for Joanne. I want Joanne on here giving a sermon. I want her live giving a sermon, right? Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, amen, she says. Whenever you're ready, sweetie. Okay, so let's pray now for everybody. And God's heard the requests. I don't think we need to really repeat them. I will hold the list up. And we can just start praying. And you want to start, Larry? Just...
First of all, we want to thank you, Father, for everything that you've done in our lives and all the people that have the faith and are getting the faith to know that prayer is the answer to many woes. Father, we hold up all of these prayers that have been asked of you to listen to and to do your will with. So, Father, we know that you heard each and every single one of them and that you will hear them throughout the following weeks to come. But Father, we lift up each and every one of them, because everyone you've told us is important, and we feel they're all important. So we lift all of these prayer requests to you, Father, and we ask that your will be done in all of those. And we ask it all in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. Father, I also want to lift up Kenny. Father, he's going back with just a big bubble in his heart, a smile on his face, and I haven't seen that from him in a very, very long time. Father, you were there at his baptism. He speaks the word all the time, and he's got extra help that I've given him throughout the way. And he's going to be in search of a building that he can be in. But Father, he's so changed right now. You've changed him so much that his wife has now asked if they can go out and look for a church together so that they can be a team when they go out. And Father, there's nothing that makes anybody happier than to have their spouse on their arm going to praise God, going to praise you, and going to learn what the word is all about. So Father, I give you praise. I give you praise, and I thank you. Amen.
Okay. Sheila, do you want to pray, man?
Not tonight.
Okay. Ed?
Dear Lord God, we come to you this moment, Lord God, and we just thank you, Lord God, for the message that you had provided for us tonight, Lord God. Lord God, let us have our altar upon our hearts, Lord God, and let our altar be fixed up and proper and fit for you, Lord Jesus. And if there's anything in there, Lord God, that needs to be repaired at our altar, Lord God, Lord God, we pray that you would bring it to our recognition, that we would recognize what we need to get fixed in our altar. Lord God, bring it to our hearts that we need to get clean and to fix up so our altar is ready for you, Lord God. Lord God, we bring these prayers to you, Lord God, and these prayer requests, Lord God. You know each and every one, Lord God. You know each and every need, Lord God. And we just pray, Lord God, that your spirit would touch each and every prayer request, Lord God, and you would reach down and touch the person that is needed for, Lord Jesus. And we thank you, Lord God, that you paid the price on the cross of Calvary, Lord God, for by your stripes we are healed. You are bruised for our iniquities, Lord God. Lord God, you paid the price already, Lord God. So we just have to accept in faith that you're going to complete that what you promised to us, Lord God. We thank you for that, Lord God. And Lord God, we just ask you, Lord, to be with each and every one of us that are on here, Lord God, that you bring us back again for another service this Wednesday for Bible study, Lord God. Keep us safe and protected and in your will and walking in your faith. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Don't forget, Catherine just asked for prayer for her sister, Anna, with breast cancer stage 4.
Wow, okay.
So we're also lifting her up, and we're lifting up your financial situation.
In the name of Jesus.
Okay. Hallelujah. Father, you heard Catherine's cry for her sister. I ask you to be with her. Touch her, heal her, Lord God. Nothing's impossible with you, and build her faith, and Father, to just lean into your arms, comfort her, send your Holy Spirit with her, and may the doctors know what they're doing, but most of all, may you, the great physician, take care of her. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, so there was one thing I was going to do before I prayed about that. So good things are happening. We've been selling furniture. I just want to let people know, and we got enough money now we got the windows and the doors for the house in Liberia, which means the family of 9 can move in. And then we'll keep fundraising until we're going to have to put the floors in and plaster the walls, but they can move in with it like it is. And then we'll look after doing the getting furniture for them. So beds, anyway, most important. Okay, so God is good. That's like 5 projects in a month and a half or so. Can you believe how good God is? Hallelujah. Let's hear it for God. Oh, yes.
Amen.
Amen. Yes. Okay. Yes, Joanne, we will get you on so that you can do that. That will be great. We'll be blessed to have you preach, honey.
Yes.
Okay. So I guess we're done for tonight. We'd like to stay on longer, but time to go. So love you all. I know. But
sounds like a Sha-na-na thing.
I know. Okay. All right, guys. Love you all very much. God bless you. Please share this message and get that heart. Oh, Karen. Whoa, before we go anywhere. Karen asked the question. She asked, how do you know what needs to be repaired? Your bird's telling us. How do we know what needs to be repaired? Who wants to answer that? How do we know what part of the altar needs to be repaired? Well, none of us can tell you. God can tell you. You need to seek his face. You need to pray. Go into a private spot and pray and ask God, is it a broken heart that I have? Is my heart hardened? Am I angry? Am I so angry inside that I just can't release forgiveness? But what is it? Ask God to show you. It might be a number of things. And then you work on it. You pray. That's the first thing you do, is you pray and you ask God to help you. All right. So if someone's broken your heart, you have to identify it and then ask God, help me, Lord, to heal that broken heart and help me to forgive that person. And help me to not hold bitterness and not have a hard heart. Maybe it was a pastor. Maybe it was a church. Whatever it was, God is going to reveal it to you. And like I said, it doesn't always happen in a second. You may have to take some time to go before God. It might be a number of things. And once you start to identify it, you talk to God about it. All you need to do, it didn't say that God told him exactly how to build the altars. They just said, build an altar. Sometimes he wanted trees around it or whatever, but he said, build an altar. So you need to just find out, okay, I've got this altar. I remember when I was first saved, I felt really, really, really close to God, right? And I could talk to him or whatever it is that you're feeling. And Father, I want that back again. Help me to repair it. And it's not like you got to go out to build all and buy all kinds of cement and wood and everything. God's got the tools right there and they're right within you. It's mostly forgiveness, hardness of heart, which is bitterness and all that. Mostly that's what happens to our hearts. And sometimes we're really mad at God about something. So start to work with it within yourself. And if you need some help, call me, message me, or Pastor Eddie, or, you know, if you need to talk to, just let us know. We'll help you to go through it. But I think you could go through this really yourself, because only you know you the best. The only other person who knows you better is God. So get together with him and ask him to help you, okay? Does that help you, Karen? I hope so. All right. I think we're done. Love you guys. We'll see you on Wednesday, 7 o'clock. Be there. Bye, everybody. Bye-bye.